when this site was first opened up to the public, just to get a peek at what was here, and when we were lobbying the city, we knew about just graffiti on the attic walls. But we then found, gee, the soldiers didn't just go up to the attic to write. And so we have uncovered graffiti both in on the first and second floors. All right, the Blenheim Wilcoxon Farm. The Blenheim name is first used in 1903 by Mary Wilcoxon, Albert's wife. The Wilcoxon Farm was 367 acres in 1860. And it came down to the 12 acres we have today just before 1950. Reason and Betsy Wilcoxon had owned this land from about 1806, 1807, and they had 10 children, Albert being the ninth of 10. Albert Wilcoxon, as you can see, was born in 1825 and died in 1889. This was the land that he was born on. And in 1855, a year after he purchased the land from his father, Reason Wilcoxon, he had a problem because his house burned down. We believe that was the frame structure that most of the Wilcoxon children had been born in. He died in 1889. Mary died in 1903. Here you see daughter Maud Wilcoxon, who died at age 6 months. We believe she was the third child. The first child was Harry, born in 1859, and the second child was Bessie, who was born in 1860. A very young family at the time of the Civil War. And the house was born about 1859, so all these very new things on this property. And he did take out a fire insurance for 3 years, but when he built the house, but he had no idea what was going to happen on his land. Fairfax Courthouse was a strategic area. Like today, it is crisscrossed with Little River Turnpike and what today we call 123. This is a map from the Library of Congress, but it is a topographical engineer map from 1862 that the Union made. And here we have the name Wilcoxon. So why on the Union map are all these people's names? Well, if you were a Union officer bringing your troops out, good farmland to camp out on. And so it gave you a route and saw the surrounding properties and where you could hole up for a while. The Fairfax Courthouse area was in Confederate control until late 1861. But by March of 1862, the Union soldiers came in, and we have three periods of signing on the walls of our house. And we date it by the dates that are written on the wall, also by the regiments who were here, looking at the official records and all to know when they were located at Fairfax Courthouse. The earliest time period, March 1862, was a two-week period of signing in which 75% of the positively ID'd soldiers wrote on the walls. These troops had come into town from Washington with General McClellan. Many of you know about General McClellan and his shortcomings, but his troops loved him, at least at the beginning, before they went on to the Peninsula campaign to try and work their way up to Richmond. This is just to give you a sampling of what we have on the walls. This is a portion of the attic. We have everything from a horse's head to a little donkey over here. You'll see C.H. Johnson, Company M, 1st Michigan Cavalry. He writes on every wall, very large. We have games that we still have not been able to interpret. We have soldiers who are telling you who they were, where they're from. Here we have Matthew Meade Marshall. He's the earliest date that we have figured out on the wall, March 11th, 1862, and just those last 2 weeks of March. And he's the only one from the 13th New York whose name we've found. We have many of our German soldiers all in a row here. We have the John Haingartner and John Dallinger and Christian Spiegel. Haingartner and Dallinger were both from Company K of the 29th Regiment New York State Volunteers, but they were out of Philadelphia. Company K was recruited in Philadelphia. We have Christian Spiegel, says 74, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, also German-born. And he was with the 74th Pennsylvania Infantry. We have probably the largest collection of German-born soldiers, Union soldiers, who wrote their names on houses during the Civil War. So it's one of our other claims to fame. We have images, tools of the trade. So we have this wonderful charcoal drawing, and that's one of the primary tools for writing on the walls. Of a cannon and cannonballs, and charcoal's not easy to draw with. So Theodore Raeffler, he says, and excuse my German, said he's from Aus Hohenzollern Sigmaringen, and says he's Preußen or Prussian. And this is the seal, the crest, from the area that he was from in southwestern Germany. We have these stars, these eight-pointed stars, that we think might just be a game. The Germans seem to use this heavy charcoal when they first come in. But if you notice, all the stars are drawn from the right, starting in the right-hand upper right-hand corner, and they're all done in one stroke of the charcoal. The second time period is illustrated by M.H. Coates, Morris Coates with the 136th Regiment, New York State Volunteers, and Thomas Perrine, also with the 136th New York State Volunteers. They were new recruits in the fall of 1862 and landed in Fairfax Courthouse. This was after Second Manassas, or Second Bull Run, as they would refer to it. And they were part of the 11th Army Corps that was overseen by General Franz Sigel, who was German-born. What is remarkable is each of our soldiers, once we are able to identify them, we then go to the National Archives, and we're fortunate in that they're Union soldiers. We can easily get their records, we can get their service file, and, if it's available, a pension file. And the pension file has all the meat in it, because it gives us genealogy. It gives us the ability to try and trace and find descendants, which we have been successful at some points. But what happens to poor Morris Coates and Thomas Perrine, new recruits, they had not been exposed to too many diseases from where they were from. Suddenly, they're with battle-worn troops, who many of them are succumbing to illness, typhoid fever, diarrhea, dysentery, all these fun communicable diseases. And they just didn't have the immunity. There ended up being from early October 1862 to late January of 1863, 1,800 soldiers sick at Fairfax Courthouse from the 11th Army Corps. So they sent five regiments out to this property. And on this property, most were camped out in tents, and the sickest were brought in-house. And that happened throughout Fairfax Courthouse. Here we have the register of the sick and wounded. And it says here, Reserve Hospital, 11th Army Corps, Fairfax Courthouse, Virginia. Think of a reserve hospital as your field hospital for the sick. So many people getting sick, didn't have time to get them into Alexandria and DC. They had to deal with them now. So this is the reserve hospital that was set up during that time period. Here's the name of a soldier, the rank, regiment or corps, company, and complaint. As I mentioned, most of the complaints were dysentery and diarrhea and typhoid fever. But looking at those 1,800 soldiers, most came in with intermittent fever, and that was then a symptom of what later could have become typhoid fever and such. Reviewing the pension files from some of the soldiers, we see that. The biggest complaint was rheumatism. You think of how much time soldiers spent walking and change of temperature. The 136th New York didn't get their tents for a couple of days, and it was a cold, rainy time, and sleeping out on the ground. Heat, mud, cold, all those different things, wear and tear, carrying backpacks and such. And so it's not surprising. And that rheumatism follows soldiers through their lives as veterans. In December of 1862, you do find a few gunshot wounds, and that was probably because there was a certain man named J.E.B. Stuart who came through Dumfries and Burke and such. So there were a couple of vulnus scleptici, as it's stated in the register of the sick and wounded. This, we believe, was a Prussian observer that Theodor Raefler, because it's written by his name, that he may have drawn. L.F. Hook writes over why he did this, I don't know, but a stanza of the Star-Spangled Banner. So there's a patriotic theme coming in. L.F. Hook is one of my favorite people in that in his information it says he's born at sea or in the ocean on the census records. He worked as a hair spinner in Philadelphia making fish lures. So look, Hook, born at sea, fishing lures, a name that just was all fit together. We have writings big, Carl Schlingermann, Zimmermann aus Balingen. We're not going to find out who that Zimmermann is. We even have a B.O. Smith on the wall. Zimmermann and Smith are about the same when trying to look up a name. Carl Schlingermann is much easier. He came into New York City in summer of 1861. By September, he was in the 58th Regiment, New York State Volunteers. He apparently did not want to go into the eight-year Prussian Army, and he wanted to join the U.S. Army. There were also offers of citizenship and such, which helped encourage people. But he's mortally wounded at Second Bull Run for him, and he was brought to Washington, D.C., where he died 16 days later. They don't even describe his gunshot wounds. He is buried up near Lincoln's Cottage in the Soldier and Sailor Cemetery up there. Not even in the country 14 months, and trying to get behind that of somebody who came, obviously believed in what was he was fighting for and gave his life for it. I mentioned we uncovered graffiti. Well, first we had to take wallpaper off the walls. When we go into the house, if those have not toured, you'll see that it's not a nice, pristine, beautifully kept period room house, because what we wanted was on the walls. So we first hired Sue Nash, a wallpaper expert, to take wallpaper off, and then we hired Kirsten Travers, to remove paint. In one room, which had the most changes over those many generations of time, look at all the paint that she had to go through. There were usually only two or three layers in the other rooms, and what she discovered after doing test spots was that they all wrote on the bare plaster. So she could then move through the upper layers of plaster, but when it got down to that last layer, that's a big Q-tip, basically, with a light solution, and that's how she patiently uncovered the walls, the paint from the house. Our favorite thing is our patriotism series. It was discovered Kirsten's second day working in 2006. Talk about making somebody want to keep going. But it starts off with a civilian who's dressed in a civilian outfit, waving a flag coming out of his hat, and he is just thrilled to be part of, to have this war begin. And he says, beginning of war, very patriotic. Now he's enlisted, standing at attention, and he says, first month, still patriotic. Now he's sitting on a box that says hard bread. And this is the difference when you're trying to look at graffiti that's been covered by different layers of paint and wallpaper. It's not so clear. Here's his cup. He's bringing something up to his mouth. First month, hard bread, hard on patriotism. But his spirits are raised because it says second month, payday, patriotic again. And here is a smile and a wad of cash. And look at that foot stride. He's walking down, marching down to that courthouse and meeting up with those settlers who were thrilled to take the money from soldiers. But I'm sorry, he did not make a very wise decision. And here it says, patriotic ale. And he falls down. And look at that face. Have you ever seen such a forlorn face? And his uniform. He has a rip on the elbow, backside, and knee of his uniform. And his final statement is, fourth month, no money, no whiskey, no friends, no rations, no peas, no beans, no pants, and no patriotism. After 4 months, That's how he felt. Now, not surprisingly, he did not put his name on this. He did put a thumbprint instead, did not want his commanding officer to know. But we do know he was with the 4th New York Cavalry, Company C. But Frank N. May had a lot else to say in the first floor of the house. He says, only in Cattaraugus County, New York State, and now in Company I, 64th New York State Volunteers. What a gem, because he helped us with our research. But he goes on to say, it's too bad to destroy property in this way, as he's doing what? Writing on the walls. And I can't get all the words, but basically he says, this is just not the way of soldiers, which we know is a blatant lie. But we have a blog, because here, somebody responds and says, no, indeed, this is the work of devils. And he blames it on Blenker's Dutch division. Now, Louis Blenker was a colonel, German-born, and his soldiers were signing on the walls in the other room at the same time. But let's blame it on the new immigrants who are coming in. Okay, this is another favorite illustration, and you probably can tell from this what we are alluding to here. We have a balloon, and the first one lifted off in 1861 in the summer over from Falls Church and came over Fairfax Courthouse, or at least near it. So, but these soldiers would have been familiar with that. And this is just our Thaddeus Lowe, who has been at our Civil War days. We've had 5 generations of family who've come to visit Henry Van Ewyk's signature. He was a sign painter. See how beautiful he wrote? But he also was quite the artist, because this is his self-portrait that he painted after the war. October 29th, 1862, from the Wisconsin Volunteers, 26. Now, I had this picture up at the very beginning. This is apparently bad German, but badly written, worded German. But basically, it says mischievous handwritings on the wall. And so I think for the most part, aside from this is who I am, I think they realized that this was graffiti. And you know, we can't even imagine what it was like for the family to have this. But fortunately, this graffiti could be covered over. And the house, it's amazing. I really truly believe in the oral history that there was a presence here simply because the house remained standing. And we know of other homes like Thomas Love. His house was taken down brick by brick when they had left as refugees in 1860. It came down in 1864. Other graffiti houses. Well, there are panels from the William Gunnell House, the headquarters of Edwin Stoughton, who was captured by Mosby and on March 9th, 1863. We have 3 of these panels here in our gallery, and these panels were written on in 1864 when it was being used as a hospital. We are part of the Northern Virginia Civil War Graffiti Trail, and that includes the Graffiti House, which is down near Brandy Station, which has both Union and Confederate writings, and they're just phenomenal. We have the Old Courthouse Civil War Museum, in Winchester, used both as hospital and jail, and Ben Lomond Historic Site, though mostly they interpret the hospital after First Manassas Bull Run. And finally, Mount Zion Park, which is new, was the newer addition to our trail, and they have some things uncovered, and they're trying to figure out which direction to go and how much to uncover. And then there are other places not on our trail, but in Suffolk, Riddick's Folly. David Goff House was used. This is actually written on the walls. That's graffiti, Beverly Union Hospital. And recently we found things not on the walls, but behind the walls. We have 3 shoes, two women's shoes. We have a boy's shoe. We have a Union spur. We have ceramics, lots of textiles that the mice loved, little corn cobs, even a mouse skeleton. But this is the area, and it was found when boards were removed from the upstairs room, and the wall upstairs was already all the way back to the outer wall, whereas downstairs there was a wall by the fireplace plane, and so these were found in between those areas. So it was quite exciting. We have our Civil War Day. We have talks all the time. We've had book fairs. We have student groups. We have descendants who've come. And when these 2 and 3 year olds were here, we were in the dining room, and I was thinking about Harry and Bessie, age 2 and 3. What, you know, that this is the age of those children when all these soldiers came through, and how frightening it must have been for them, and as parents trying to care for them as well. So here we are, and I'm so glad you came today.
The Civil War romance of Antonia Ford and Major Joseph Willard is one of several acts and contains all the elements of good theater. At the beginning of the Civil War, Fairfax Courthouse was, as today, located on major east, west, and north-south routes, 16 miles from Washington, D.C. At the beginning of the Civil War, Virginia, of course, as you know, voted for secession, seceded from the Union in May of 1861. And the Fairfax Courthouse area was under control of the Confederates. And this is the Ford home where Antonia Ford and her family lived. It was built between 1835 and 1840, located on the east side of today's Chainbridge Road. The house is still standing. Born in 1838, Antonia Ford was the eldest of 5 children. Her father was known as E.R. Ford. He was a merchant. He voted for secession. She came from a long line of Virginians. An ancestor, John Ford, had received a land grant from Lord Fairfax in the 1730s. She was also a well-educated young Virginia woman. She attended the school that you see here in this photograph, located in Fairfax Courthouse, called Coombe Cottage for Women, and then later the Buckingham Preparatory Institute. The story about Antonia Ford's role as an informant or a spy for the Confederacy began early in the war. And this image is from a Harper's Weekly, showing her allegedly riding around Union troops to warn General Beauregard's camp near Manassas. She clearly was a favorite in the social set of the Confederate officers when they were here at Fairfax Courthouse. And what you see on the screen is an honorary aide-de-camp issued by General Stuart to Antonia Ford. This is really, it's called a military commission, but it has no power or authority. It was issued really by Stuart as a compliment. Now, things changed rather rapidly in the first part of the war here in Fairfax Courthouse. The Confederates in late 1861 moved their headquarters from Fairfax Courthouse to Centerville. And in March of 1862, Union forces began moving in full force. One of the Union officers arriving in Fairfax Courthouse that spring of 1862 is then Captain Joseph C. Willard. As Southern as Antonia was, the Willard family was very Northern. He came from Vermont, from a merchant business family. His brother, Henry, had purchased a hotel in Washington, D.C., and invited his brother Joseph to come into the hotel business with him. He's not someone who had to join the Union Army, but did, and joined as a captain. And we know that he came to Fairfax Courthouse on April the 9th, because 1862, because he recorded it in his daily log that he kept. He said, arrived at Fairfax Courthouse in, quote, a severe snowstorm, and we were quartered at the Ford House. 22 years later, in 1884, Willard wrote in that year's day book, quote, snowstorm, as on the date 22 years ago, the day I first saw my dear, dear Antonia. But let's fast forward to March of 1863. On the night of March 8th and 9th, 1863, John S. Mosby, the newly minted leader of the 43rd Battalion Partisan Rangers, and 29 of his men made a daring raid into the courthouse area and captured Union General Edwin H. Stoughton, who was asleep in his bed. And so the Union Army arrested six prominent men in Fairfax Courthouse, known to have voted for secession and known to be sympathetic to the Confederacy. One of those men was Antonia Ford's father, E.R. Ford. A few days later, Antonia herself was arrested after the Union Army sent in a female informant to become friendly with Antonia Ford. And supposedly at that time, Antonia Ford showed her the honorary aide-de-camp paper that had been issued by J.E.B Stuart. Antonia Ford and the others were taken to this prison called Old Capitol Prison. After 2 months, records at the National Archives list her as one of the several prisoners transferred to City Point, Virginia. And that was a point of prisoner exchange during the war. However, she did not return home to Fairfax Courthouse, but spent the summer of 1863 with family and friends in the Culpeper area. And fortunately, there is a fragment of a letter that she wrote to her father during this time. And while she doesn't mention Willard by name, she does tell her father and describes a handsome visitor in a Union uniform. Then at this time also that spring, Willard, who had been assigned to the division of the Rappahannock, requests a transfer to the Military District of Washington, which was the controlling command for the old Capitol prison. After being in the Culpeper area that summer, she was arrested again in early September of 1863 and taken back to Old Capitol Prison, where this time, on September the 16th, 1863, both she and her father signed the Oath of Allegiance to the United States and are allowed to return home to Fairfax Courthouse. Now, who do you think may have witnessed her oath and then received a U.S. government pass to escort her home? Major Willard. And it's upon her return to Fairfax Courthouse that the surviving correspondence between Ford and Willard begins. The letters are indeed love letters, filled with endearments, romantic prose, and testimonials of devotion. In one to Willard, she wrote, "I bid you adieu until the candles are lit in the parlor and the stars are in the cold wintry sky. I send you my hair according to promise. I've charmed it to woo the sunshine into your life." And after one of Willard's visits here to Fairfax Courthouse, she wrote, quote, "You have hallowed this place with your presence. Every spot recalls you. This sofa you sat on when you said you love me." Another time she wrote, "My sole ambition will be to reign queen of hearts over you, my pupil. No graduating will be allowed, and the longer you study, the less probability of the school closing." But again, this is just not a paper romance. Willard uses the pass and manages several visits to what Antonia Ford called in her letters the extreme verge of Union Town. Willard either takes the train to Fairfax Station or to nearby Sangster Station, and she constantly worries about his capture. In one letter she wrote, quote, "I should want to behead Mosby if he should capture you," and vows to accompany Willard if he goes to prison. And then apparently she went back and reread what she had just written and added this line as a postscript, quote, "Isn't that harsh talk for one considered to be a Confederate heroine?" While the letters are definitely personal, there are also some hints of political thought. We may never know the exact truth of Antonia Ford's actions, but in her letters, we do have her life in her own words. Quote, "I claim no military title, neither connection with Army arrangements, and never have. Jests on the subject have brought me into too much trouble to be repeated. And she confirms her political loyalty and personal loyalty constantly in letters to Willard. She also sought to allay Willard's apparent concern over their age difference. She is 25 and he is 43. On one occasion, when Union officers came to the Ford House asking for her, she wrote to Willard, quote, "I emphatically decline to make an appearance. Stars have no attraction for me. I much prefer the leaf." And if you're a military person, you'll know that stars are the rank of a colonel, and the leaf is the rank of a major. Now, in addition to all of this going on, the relationship also faced a very practical problem. He was married, and he was in the process of seeking a divorce, but as you probably know, divorce was not easily obtained or very common. Willard apparently proposed the idea of what he termed a private marriage. Now today, I think we'd call that living together. And I think in one of the most telling letters of all about Antonia Ford's character, about her respect for her parents and her community, comes from her answer to him. "Here I am on the night of 31 December 1863 in the village of Fairfax in the mansion of E.R. Ford. You know I love you, Major, but I can never consent to a private marriage. My parents and relatives would be mortified and distressed to death. Acquaintances would disown me. It would be illegal, and above all, it would be wrong. You ask for my heart and hand. My heart is yours already. When your hand is free, you can claim my hand before the world." The relationship after that letter was broken off. And at one point in early January, she wrote Willard, "Have you burned my letters? I ask it as a last favor." In turn, Willard wrote to her, "Miss Ford, let the story go with the dying embers." We know that Willard did not burn her letters because quite a full complement exists, either in our collection or at the Library of Congress. However, only a few of Willard's letters to Antonia exist. After this breakup, Antonia Ford's mother, Julia, intercedes again for her daughter's welfare, writing Willard, "I can't stand the wildness of my poor child's heart. Take the train to Sangster Station. Walk up the hill to the Ford House. We will meet you there." And in late January, they met again at the Ford home at Sangster Station and patched up their quarrel. At that point, Willard also must have won acceptance from the Ford family, because in Antonia's January 25th letter to him, she noted for the first time, quote, "Mother sends her love." In the following letters of early winter 1864, she returns to playfully chiding him about being, quote, "a Yankee," writing that it was really a mistake. "You were meant to be a Virginian. I know you are true to your government, but I love you nonetheless for it. With all my heart, I believe in one union. Do you know what union that is?" Willard resigned his commission from the U.S. Army on March the 1st, 1864, and was granted a divorce from Caroline Willard on March the 3rd. Then the couple began to make wedding plans, disguised as preparations for Ford to visit an aunt and uncle who lived in Philadelphia at that time. She writes, "The villagers," talking about the people here in Fairfax, "are hoodwinked as regards my visit," and says, "If I am content, what difference should it make to them?" Quote, "You have made a more favorable impression than any other federal, Every Ford is now in your firm camp. With his hand free to remarry, Willard wrote to Antonia's father, quote, "Your dear daughter, Antonia, will soon be transferred to my care. My first desire is to make her as happy as in my power." Willard arrived with a hired carriage in Fairfax Courthouse on the morning of March the 10th, 1864. They were married at the New York Avenue Presbyterian Church and then took the train to Philadelphia for their honeymoon. Antonia remained very close to her family and often visited Fairfax Courthouse. The summer after her marriage, when she was back in Fairfax Courthouse, she wrote her new husband this, quote, "I knew I could not revenge myself on the whole nation, but felt very capable of tormenting one Yankee, so I took the major." On May the 1st, 1865, Antonia and Joseph Willard welcomed their first son, Joseph Edward Willard. A second son, Charles, named for Antonia's brother, was born in 1867. And visiting her family in August of that year, she writes Willard, quote, "Both of our boys are unusually interesting and promising children. I trust we may raise them and live to be proud of them." Sadly, a few weeks later, four-month-old Charles Willard died, likely from a strep throat. And in the following 2 years, Antonia went through what Willard called great distress and sadness. And it seems from reading the letters that she suffered two miscarriages during the late 1860s. But despite this, the marriage certainly seems to be a happy one. In 1868, she wrote to him, "If our letters were opened and read, they would suppose we were just married. 4 years is a right long honeymoon, is it not? In 1870, she was pregnant again and wrote Willard, "What a prolific combination that a secession Yankee we are." On February the 7th, 1871, Willard wrote his father-in-law, "Antonia is very sick. She wants her mother and you. This carriage is to bring you to Washington in haste." 2 days later, on February the 9th, their son Archie died at birth. For the next few days, Willard's daybook records purchases of medicines and payments for doctor's visits. Antonia Ford, though, became a statistic, and she died of complications of childbirth on Valentine's Day, February the 14th, 1871. According to the obituary in the Washington Star, Antonia asked her sister Patty to take care of young Joseph, not yet six. And Willard recorded her death in his daybook this way, "My dear wife died this morning at 5:08. Notice in the Washington Star, 50 cents. 2 weeks after her daughter's death, Julia Ford wrote Willard, quote, "Our bereavement has cast a gloom over our little village. In every room of our home, there's something that reminds me of my great sadness. As a young gay girl, she was the life and light of our home." Willard never remarried, and his day books are filled with remembrances of their life short marriage together, and his recordings of visiting her grave, of planting ivy, of buying a frame for her portrait, and making notes on days in their lives, for example, saying, 11 years ago, my dear Antonia was taken from me. We had been so happy." And I would like to conclude with another quote from Dr. Sussman, who said, "History is really communicating through time and space. The story of Antonia Ford and Joseph Willard, their romance, their love, their losses, and the legacy of public service and community generosity resonates with us through the passage of time and generations, and hopefully helps us better understand the artifacts and landscape of our Fairfax community. Thank you very much.
Let's start with the situation in Fairfax County in the fall of 1861 and the spring of 1862. Of course, we had the Battle of First Manassas in July of 1861. But after the battle, J.E.B. Stuart, who we have shown here, was in charge of all the Confederate forces in Fairfax County. He had 1,500 horsemen and 250 men on his staff. I'm going to talk about a woman named Laura Ratcliffe. Well, and I started off with J.E.B. Stuart. So they met in December of 1861 after the Battle of Drainsville. Stuart brought some of his wounded soldiers not only back to his headquarters, but some of them were taken to Frying Pan Church, which is along Centerville Road. And that church does still stand today. This was about a mile and a half from where Laura Ratcliffe lived. And she went up and tended to some of Stuart's wounded soldiers. She also went over to Camp Qui Vive, Stuart's headquarters, and was tending to some of the wounded soldiers there. And that's where she met J.E.B. Stuart. And it was written that J.E.B. Stuart was captivated by Laura's beauty, pleasant nature, and helpfulness. So who is Laura Ratcliffe? Laura Ratcliffe was born in 1836. I believe this picture was taken around 1855, when she was roughly 20 years old. Prior to the Civil War, most of the people in the country were farmers. It was an agrarian society. Men and women worked side by side on their farms to run their farms and make a living. So what happens when the Civil War starts? The men go off to war, leaving the women basically to take care of themselves and their property. In Southern society, women's domain was in the house. Southern women did not leave their house without a male escort. They did not speak their minds in public. They really thought about them as sisters and daughters, and then eventually, hopefully, as to mothers and wives. But of course, with the Civil War, that all changes because there are no men to marry. And the women changed from thinking about themselves as trying to be married to the fact that it was no disgrace to become an old maid because there were no men to marry. And it was women of all classes, the rich, the poor, whoever, suffered during the war. The deprivation, hunger, and fear affected them all. But there were those, however, who did all they could to help the Southern cause. As I said, Laura was born in 1836, and the 1840 and 1850 censuses have her living somewhere over here south, if you will, of Fairfax Courthouse area on the property of an Abner Stevenson. But by 1860, she is actually living in the Fairfax Courthouse area right in here, which was the formal area right here. Her father was deceased in 1842. So by the time you get to 1860, he's been gone for a number of years, and I believe that she was living with relatives. One of the relatives that's possible that she lived with was a Margaret Farr. So she grew up around here, lived in here. Her great-grandfather lived up there on the Mount Vineyard house, Richard Ratcliffe, all around the courthouse area. After she meets J.E.B. Stuart in December of 1861, they write letters to each other. And here's a letter written January 30th, 1862, approximately a month after they met, to Miss Laura Ratcliffe and Miss Antonia Ford in Frying Pan, written by J.E.B. Stuart. After 1860, Laura moves out towards the Herndon area, living along Centerville Road, as I said, a mile and a half south of the Frying Pan Church. And that's where she lived during the war. And here's one letter that J.E.B. Stuart wrote to Laura and Antonia. They were actually cousins. It says, "My dear ladies, it is such a muddy day that I refrain from visiting you because I would dislike to appear in such an unpresentable a costume as the roads would give me. Nevertheless, you may expect me soon, rain or shine. Yours, J.E.B." So, of course, the roads weren't maintained anywhere like they are today. During the winter, the roads were muddy. J.E.B. didn't want to ride out from his headquarters 7 miles over to Frying Pan because he would have been full of mud. And probably he was probably more busy, so this was a polite way of not making it out to visit Laura. Now, in March of 1862, the Confederate Army pulls out of Northern Virginia, and they move south. J.E.B. Stuart is acting as the rear guard. And as he pulls out, he leaves Laura with an album. In it, he writes four poems to her, two which he writes himself and two which are copies of other parts of poems about the gallantry of war and the gallantry of his actions. And this is on the front page. I think you could almost read this. It says, presented to Miss Laura Ratcliffe by her soldier friend as a token of his high appreciation of her patriotism, admiration of her virtue, and a pledge of his lasting esteem. Okay, Stuart was a married man. So what is he doing giving these little gifts? He gave a captain certificate to Antonia Ford, and he gives this album to Laura Ratcliffe. So what is Mr. Stuart doing? Well, one of his biographers wrote, Stuart used the attention of women as an index of his worth. More than most men, he treasured his flirtations and, in a sense, counted them as conquests. A kiss on the cheek was something that Stuart really liked from a pretty young lady. One of his men wrote, unsurpassed for close attention to duty, General Stuart had the remarkable facility of preserving his lightness of heart under all circumstances. He was as conspicuous a leader in the ballroom as he was on the field of battle. So one thing, if you write about J.E.B. Stuart, when he moves from town to town, he always tends to stay in the house of the gentleman that has the prettiest daughters. Stuart even writes to his wife, Flora, about this subject. He says, as to being laughed at about your husband's fondness for society and the ladies, all I can say is you are better off in that than you would be if I were fonder of some other things that excite no remarks in others. In other words, he's not drinking, he's not gambling, he's just hanging around with the women. So what was Stuart doing? He was flirting because he wanted the women to spy for him. Because as I said in the opening, the men were gone. Who was left in the houses and could look out their windows and see who was traveling up and down the roads but the women? He even had money and gave money to his officers to give to the women in the local areas where he was to help them survive so they could indeed spy for him. Here's one of the poems that, that Stuart wrote. But he starts off with this poem called To Laura. It says, we once met by chance, but in that eventful chance, the mystic web of destiny was woven. Is that good, guys? You have to remember that, okay? But at any rate, he's writing about, he wants her to continue to spy for him, and he wants him to provide him with information when he comes by, because he knows Fairfax Courthouse is on the outskirts of the city of Washington, and that's where he needs to be at different points during the war. One of the other aspects of society back then was the use of calling cards. And the custom was back then, when you went to visit somebody, you didn't call ahead like we do today. You would go and present your calling card, and the servant or whoever would answer the door would take the calling card, and they would take it to whoever you're going to meet. And that person either could have you come in, or the custom was you had up to 3 days for them to get back to you and say whether or not they would receive you or whether or not they wouldn't receive you. So what Laura did in this album that J.E.B. Stuart gave her, she drew the calling cards. So as the soldiers came through and stopped at her house, those that could write, she would have them sign in. And in this album, there are 40 signatures, 26 who are from soldiers, and 14 who are from loyal Confederate civilians like herself. And of the 14 civilians that signed this album, 13 were women. So this is what I call the J.E.B. Stuart page. And it's, you can see right there in the middle, it says, your friend J.E.B. Stuart. And as was written about J.E.B. Stuart, he was either your friend or he was your enemy. There was no in between. So I think it's fair to read that, that J.E.B. Stuart was her friend. And these are some of the rest of his men. Here's John Mosby. And of course, we have what I'll call the John Mosby page up there, John S. Mosby. One of the difficulties in doing the research for these signatures is I can go back and figure out who all these men were. But the problem is these aren't dated. None of the signatures are dated. So I know that he gave her the album March 3rd, 1862, because that was on the front page. But Mosby was a major for 6 months. And during the 6 months, he was in the area of Fairfax County at least a dozen times. So he could have signed this page from August of 63 to February of 64. We'll never know exactly when he signed it, but in that six-month period, we do have an idea of when he was by. And this was signed by some of his men. This is Fitzhugh Lee, Brigadier General Fitzhugh Lee. He also visited Laura. And he's a local boy. He was born just 5 miles west of Alexandria. And there's Fitzhugh Lee right there in the middle as a brigadier general. Of course, for those who don't know, Fitzhugh Lee was the nephew of one Robert E. Lee. And he met Jeb Stuart at West Point, and he was one of the most Stuart's most trusted brigade commanders. So, of course, now we have to think about, well, when would Fitzhugh Lee have been there, Stuart been there, and Mosby been there? There are two dates in which I know that all of these men were in the area of Laura Ratcliffe's house. One was after the Battle of Chantilly in September of 1862, and the whole Confederate Army was here in Fairfax County from September 2nd to September 5th. But Stuart, Mosby, and Fitzhugh Lee were in the area on December 29th, 1862. And this is after Stuart's Dumfries raid. And here's a map which shows us approximately, well, pretty much where Laura Ratcliffe lived. Here's Frying Pan Church up here. This would be Centerville Road. This would be Route 50 down here. Now we're over in western Fairfax County. Here's a picture of the house that she lived there along Centerville Road, no longer standing, but this is approximately 1950. The brick wasn't added until 1950. It was a wooden house before that. And as I said, on December 29th, 1862, Stuart, Mosby, and Fitzhugh Lee were all in this particular house after Stuart had been on his Dumfries raid, and he had gone to Dumfries and he had gone to Burke Station. As one of the accounts of that night, as Stuart and his men were getting up to leave, Laura speaks to Stuart, and she says, "It's a shame you can't stay longer, General. It's hard on us living in conquered territory under enemy rule." As I'd mentioned, the Confederate Army had pulled out in March of 62, and now the Union soldiers were up at Frying Pan Church going up and down Centerville Road. And Stuart replies to Laura, saying, "Well, I won't desert you entirely, Miss Ratcliffe. I'm returning to Culpeper in the morning, as you know, but I mean to leave behind Captain Mosby with a few men to look after the loyal Confederate people here until we can return in force and victory." Let's turn to some of the women that I spoke about who signed this album as well. Molly Millen, okay, she's listed down here as living at the house called the Hermitage. Everybody had a name for their houses back then. Laura Monroe lived in Fairfax Courthouse area. Lucy Cockrell lived over in Loudoun County. So just to give you an idea, a little bit better picture about where we're talking about, Laura's house is here. One of the women lived up here on Route 7. One of the women lived over here in Hayfield, just over in Loudoun County. The Hermitage was right down here on Route 50, where the Costco is today. And one of the other women lived over here in Fairfax Courthouse. And I point this out because who was living right in the middle? Was Laura Ratcliffe. So these women must have traveled towards each other at different times during the war, and they signed the album. Here's another page with a number of women. Now I'm going to point out, here's Kate Carper. She lived to the north in Bloomfield. We'll show you a picture of her house in a minute. But when you look closely at the rest of all of these set of signatures, this one's perhaps the easiest to read. They're all from Cambridge, Maryland. So we've got all these women here from Cambridge, Maryland. So we have to try to figure out, how did these women all get here? If Laura had this album, I doubt very much that she would have taken this album out of her house. She would have kept it hidden. As we go through, this is Kate Carper. She signs on the page with the women from Cambridge. And that's a picture of Bloomfield, which is not our house sitting over here. Looks very similar, built in 1861. The Blenheim house here was built in 1859, and is actually very similar when you look at it. Now, this house, which is a lot larger than Laura Ratcliffe's house, I believe that these women came up from Cambridge, and they probably stayed with Kate Carper. And then we can stop for a second and say, well, how the heck did they get here? Well, here's Cambridge over here, eastern shore of Maryland. They would have come by boat down the Chesapeake, up the Potomac River to Alexandria. Okay, there's Fairfax Courthouse, Frying Pan, and Drainsville, where Bloomfield is. Okay, where did these women come from? Well, they came from Cambridge. There's the Episcopal Christ Church in Cambridge. So when I was doing the research, I had to try to figure out a connection here. Well, it turns out Laura was Episcopalian. These women were Episcopalian. But there are no records from the church here, or there are no records from the church there about the Civil War. As I mentioned, these are all from Cambridge. Here's one over here. This is Wilhelmina G. Henry from Cambridge, Maryland. I hired a genealogist who tied this all together for me. This is impossible to read. I didn't have the sun when I was down there that day. This is Wilhelmina G. Henry. Okay, she was buried in the back of that church, as most of the women from Cambridge are. The G is the important piece. It stands for Goldsboro. Okay, anybody familiar with your Annandale history? Who was the largest landowner in Annandale? Well, that would have been Anna Marie Goldsboro Fitzhugh. The Goldsboro owns that property of Ravensworth. Okay, she was the godmother of Fitzhugh Lee, who we've talked about. She was the aunt of Robert E. Lee. She was the cousin of Wilhelmina Goldsboro Henry in Cambridge. So now we have a connection between the Cambridge women and Anna Marie, who lived here during the Civil War. And this is why I love the genealogist. Her husband, William Henry Fitzhugh, was Laura's third cousin, twice removed, on Laura's father's side. Okay, so she was related to Laura, and she was also related to the women down in Cambridge, Maryland. Laura and Anna Marie went to the Episcopal Church here in Fairfax Courthouse. So there were seven women from Cambridge. We don't know precisely when they came, but they could have come for a number of reasons. One, because early in the war, Union soldiers moved into Cambridge. That would have been a front to the Southern women. They could have moved up to come up here to Fairfax Courthouse to get away from the Union soldiers down there. The loyal Confederate civilians in eastern Maryland were also smuggling supplies down the river to Richmond. After the war, one description of Laura was written as, at the end of the war, Laura was destitute, with a dilapidated house surrounded by weeds, her fences down, and the farm grown up in tall grass and briars. Her once productive farmlands had been trodden down by the enemy's cavalry and were growing up in brambles. And that was pretty much the same as the rest of Fairfax County. This is a picture of the house that she moves in 1869 after the war. Her mother buys this particular house, and we call it Mary Brook today. And no doubt struggling to make ends meet, Laura marries her wealthy next-door neighbor, a gentleman by the name of Milton Hanna, who was a Northerner. She marries when she is 54 years old. The marriage only lasted 7 years, as her husband Milton was killed in an accident. But then she inherits 200 more acres. And then she eventually gets her sister's property as well. So by the time Laura passes away, she's quite a wealthy woman. In 1914, Laura is walking out the front of her house on this flagstones back here to feed her chickens when she's 78 years old. And these are the flagstones here coming out of the front of the house. She slips and falls and breaks her hip. She lives the last 9 years of her life in bed in this house, and in 1923 dies at 87 years old. And there are stories about local people would always come by to see her, to take care of her, and she was considered very beautiful at the time she died and still considered a local legend. Today, I think the story of Laura and the album and Jeb Stuart and the civilians provides us with an interesting insight into the way people had to live during the Civil War. In the beginning of the war, the women were dependent upon the men. During the war, the soldiers in turn became dependent upon the women. And it was after the war, especially in the South, that the women took over, coming up with new societies and so forth, coming out from being the purview of the home to pretty much running things in the South. And on May 4th, just recently, there was a dedication of a Civil War trails marker at Mary Brook in the background. Amy Beechler here is portraying Laura. That's why I put this picture up there. I think she looks just like Laura. Myself, Jimmy Fleming as Mosby, and Wynn Meiselman is the owner of Mary Brook as well. But I will close by reading one of these writings that a Confederate general wrote after the war. He says, "It was upon the women that the greatest burden of this horrid war fell. While the men were carried away with the drunkenness of the war, she dwelt in the stillness of their desolate home. May the movement to erect monuments in every southern state to our heroic southern women carve in marble a memorial to her cross and passion."